Holly Carnes.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you all for appearing before the committee today and being willing to share your lived experiences with all of us. People with autism are a diverse cohort with different individual needs, which you all elaborated on the change across your lives, and our state services haven't caught up with an understanding of this to provide the proper range of educational, health and social support services required for people to exercise their rights. And David, you're quite right, nor have they allocated the adequate funding to do so. And, you know, that's all of our jobs here to push for that, because the department's own capacity review, I think, you know, this year concluded that we needed $350 million to meet the unmet needs of people with disabilities, and less than a sixth of that was allocated. So we very obviously need structures, resources and all of the other things to ensure that people with disabilities can access education, employment, housing is a major one. And like Adam rightly pointed out, you know, the need to ratify the optional protocol of the UN Convention is really key to that. And it really is disgraceful that that hasn't happened yet. And I would like to assure you all that, you know, we'll do our very best to try and make that happen. That is the purpose of this committee. And we'll keep pushing for that. Unfortunately, I can't ask all the questions I have due to time constraints. So I'm just going to ask a few. But if any of you have other points that there isn't time to respond, I'd love like a written response, or you can get in touch with my office and I'll get back to you. So the vital role of carers and families is a clear theme, I think, in today's session. Unfortunately, so is the reality that your efforts usually go unappreciated by the state. Carers are consistently overlooked, despite the incredibly important and often very exhaustive work that they do and will keep doing out of love and dedication. David, I couldn't agree more with your call for a statutory provision for families and guardians and carers for a liaison office within the Disability Department. I'm wondering if you could elaborate on the importance of this to the committee. And Jean, you also outlined the need to recruit more people to provide in-home respite for exhausted parents, and how, you know, the provision of other services, travelling remotely and being provided in the home, could address some of the issues around rural transport. So I'm just wondering if you could elaborate a bit more on how you would see that working. And then just if there's time as well, a recurring point raised is the additional stress and hardship put on families in trying to negotiate different state and publicly funded services. And in most cases, like you've all outlined, you have to fight for basic services. And, you know, I often hear people having to turn to online groups to get information and advice. And while we have agencies like the National Advocacy Service, is it time, do you think, for a new service in which families are given kind of a single point of contact who can help them navigate the services? Tom, you specifically raised issues with agencies, so I'm wondering if you could elaborate on the potential solutions for families. And Jean, I'd ask you the same question from the perspective of somebody living in a rural area specifically, because I know from, you know, since becoming a public representative, the issues that people are facing in relation to this. In my own constituency, people are travelling, you know, a three-hour round trip to get 30 minutes of essential speech and language therapy that they've been waiting for over 2 years. So I'll leave it at that for now, Chair. Thank you so much.
Okay, who would like to speak first? Jean, you have your hand up.
Yes, it's sorry, I forgot to keep my hand down from last time. But anyway, yes, I can say a few things here, and thank you for the opportunity, Deputy Cairns. So the subject of respite, I mean, a number of parents have mentioned this, and I mean, it's a no-brainer, isn't it? You know, you've got parents like me getting older, and you know, people offering 24/7 care, it's 365 days a year, and you know, it's endless. So obviously respite is essential. And if you, you know, if you're lucky enough to have a large extended family nearby, then perhaps you can, you know, you can ask for their help, although that in many ways is less than ideal. But for many people, you know, they're just on their own. I would say it's particularly acute for, you know, obviously there are a number of lone parents. You know, I'm fortunate and I have my husband here to back me up. But for lone parents, you know, there's no break at all. Again, thinking about this family, I know this widow, anytime she has to bring her autistic son to an appointment, you know, she has to bring her other son along with them. So that means that the older boy misses a day's school, and of course it's a long journey for her, and it's absolutely exhausting. So the answer, well, part of the answer would seem to be to have either people available, and she has applied for this, but the waiting list, you don't even know how long the waiting lists are because they don't tell you, but you just apply and then you just wait and nothing happens. But obviously the ideal solution would be if somebody could come to her home to perhaps look after one child while she is gone, or alternatively a solution might be to have a drop-in centre where trained people could look after people with disabilities on a short-term basis. Longer term, well, then you get into weekends and holidays and all of that. And again, you know, there are some resources available, but personally, I've never been able to avail of them. So I don't quite know how that works. Your other point about navigating services, I think one thing that would be hugely helpful would be to have a directory of services. You know, it takes an awful lot of time even just to find out who to phone, who to contact. And I know there have been some directories made in our area for services for children, but there should also be a directory of services, you know, across the board for all ages, because it can be really difficult to find out even, you know, who to contact to access a service. So that might be something that might be looked at there. And yes, I think I've already addressed the transport issue. So that is a huge issue. And the other thing I read about the other day was, I think in Greece they have mobile mental health units, and we all know that post-pandemic there's been a huge surge in the need for mental health services. So, and again, you know, very difficult for people to travel into services. So why not have a mobile unit? I mean, that's just another out-of-the-box suggestion that might solve part of that issue.
Okay, thanks, Jean. David?
Thank you. Just to go back to you about the statutory office for guardians and carers, you know, I really think the family and the carers' input into service delivery is essential. We are the experts. We actually know, and the people themselves, we know best. Okay, but we're probably, most family members are burnt out, you know, and they're finding it really, really difficult. You know, where do they go? Okay, who do they go to? But by having a statutory office, you know, that one office that they can actually contact and represent their views, they can highlight the gaps in services. I really think it's essential. I really, people are burnt out. During my, I suppose, tours around looking for answers, a saying that came up by a psychologist in America was, a person's needs are best met by a person whose needs are met. And, you know, if you take that to the logic, you know, we have people at home, and if you can look after the family who are looking after the people, and if you can look after their needs, okay, that person's needs are best met. And that's what brings me to the respite care. It's a hugely valuable service. You know, everybody needs a break, not only for the family themselves, but also for the person who is actually receiving the break. To get a break from the family themselves, and they need it just as much. And so it's a service that is underestimated or undervalued. Yeah, when you look at the comptroller and auditor general, was that a talk he was giving about value for money? And it actually wasn't about cost. It was about effectiveness. It was about efficiencies. And then it came in about the cost. And the value of keeping people at home as long as you can, the long-term plans, is a huge value and a cost-saving measure for this country. And if you can just provide some respite care to give those people a break, to keep the crisis from coming, the emergency from coming, and keep it, push it down the line by giving just a small amount, giving the family support, either in respite or in home support, you know, if they just looked at the long-term economic value to this country, it actually would be huge. And I think more money would be put in to respite and support for the families. So that's really it.
Thanks, David. Okay, we'll move on to Senator Alice Mary Higgins.